Scientists and philosophers like to think that they're very sober, rational people who are above the need to advertise. And yet, if you look closely, you'll see that they often go to great lengths to come up with a vivid, memorable term, a label for their theory, or a name for it that will stick in people's heads. They're, in other words, they're trying to develop a brand name or advertising or a trademark for their view. And we should recognize that's a good thing to do. If you're going to run an example or if you're going to run an argument, try to make it as easy as possible for the audience or the reader to keep track of the elements. Don't call them A, B, C, D, and E. Call them Bill and Arthur and Freddie and so forth. But of course, that can backfire on you too, or it can be misused. One of my favorite bad thought experiments, bad intuition pumps, is one in a very influential paper by Green and Cohen, published in the Proceedings of the Royal Society, on what neuroscience tells us about free will. And this is the boys from Brazil. And in this thought experiment, we're to imagine, this, it's inspired by the hokey science fiction film, The Boys from Brazil, about some evil doctors who clone Hitler, and they're trying to make Hitler clones. And, but in this telling, they create a human being who's been designed by their evil intentions to live a life of crime, to do evil things. But just as rational as anybody else, he's very much controlled. He's sort of a designed psychopath. And they call him Mr. Puppet. And they describe Mr. Puppet, and Mr. Puppet goes out and commits a crime. And they appeal to the readers that conclude that Mr. Puppet isn't really responsible for his evil deeds. He shouldn't be punished, certainly. Yeah, he's just the victim of his circumstances. And then, bless them, they say, now Daniel Dennett might object that this is just an intuition pump and that we shouldn't take it seriously. Yes. It's not that it's an intuition pump. Intuition pumps can be good. It's a bad intuition pump. And they say, they just, having noticed, having imagined that I might be critical of their intuition pump, they go ahead and do it anyway. So let me now turn the knobs on this intuition pump and we'll see what we can make of it. First, they say, the fact that this person was created by evil scientists with evil intent, that's irrelevant to the example, really. So, all right, so let's get rid of them. We'll turn that knob. And so an indifferent environment produces a human being who, they say, by design, is set out on a sort of antisocial trajectory. Well, but we can get rid of that by design, too, because if it's an indifferent environment, then there's no intent on this. So we've got this, an indifferent environment happens to produce an individual who with high probability will engage in some criminal activities, let's say. And then they imagine that he kills somebody in a drug bust or something, like in a drug deal gone bad. Well, that's inessential, so we're going to change the crime. We're going to make it he kills somebody who's witnessed some embezzlement that he's done. It shouldn't make any difference. If you thought that the Mr. Puppet in the first instance wasn't responsible and shouldn't be held responsible, then this shouldn't change it. Now I want to change just one more thing. They keep talking about Mr. Puppet. Okay, that's a nice vivid name, but it's just a name. Shouldn't make any difference. So I'm going to change it. Let's call Mr. Puppet, Captain Autonomy. Okay, so now Captain Autonomy is caused by an indifferent environment to enter on a trajectory where it becomes likely that he's going to commit some antisocial behavior. And now the question is whether he should be held responsible. Well, I think Captain Autonomy, why shouldn't he be held responsible? Let me flesh it out a little bit more. Let's suppose that Captain Autonomy is a Harvard graduate who goes to work at Lehman Brothers and sees a clever way of embezzling a few million dollars and has pulled off his white-collar crime when he discovers a person who has about to expose him. And he lures him to the edge of the balcony in the high rise and pushes him off, and he falls to his death. Now, that's my case. Now, are we so clear that Captain Autonomy is not responsible for his deed? It seems to me that I've drained the example of most of the oomph that provided the intuitions. I'm not saying that my retelling of it shows that he is responsible. I'm just pointing out that those details, which presumably are ad lib and they shouldn't make a difference, they make a huge difference into how we think about this person and whether or not to hold him responsible.